Hello, Roy. How are you? Good to see
Here, how are
you.
you doing?
Yeah, I'm fine.
You know, I
Great.
know you don't like to be early for airplanes either. You get yourself settled and I'm gonna embarrass you with some intro stuff. Okay, so if it's possible that any of you don't know Professor Pierre Janin, I could characterize his research as mixed reality and image-guided surgery, possibly surgical skills analysis, and surgical process modeling. But his career spans certainly probably something like a quarter of a century. I've known him personally for about half that time, going way back to probably the grandfather of this conference set. It was called Medicine Meets Virtual Reality, and it was a great way to meet on the California beaches and have a good time. Pierre and I have known each other that long. We've visited each other's labs, we've been at each other's homes, and we've gone to concerts together. Sandrine and I have a daughter, Maya. Hello, Maya. She's watching from in Switzerland. And Pierre is her godfather. So, in addition, Pierre heads the INSERM research group at Rennes, the Medicis group, modeling surgical knowledge and processes. Probably, in addition to being editor of journals and writing many papers and supervising many students, in his spare time, he and his team organize major conferences. Those of you who were at CARS 2019 in Rennes will remember what a spectacular event that was. Pierre, take it away.
Merci, Roy. Thanks a lot for your very kind introduction. And I'm very pleased to be here, and I'm very thankful to Matthias and to the group in Germany and Switzerland to invite me. What I like probably the most in our area, in our research area, is the atmosphere, the friendly atmosphere we were able to set up years after years. And when I see all the prestigious invited speakers, the whole week and next week, I'm very pleased to see people that are almost as much friend that the experts, and I'm very pleased about that. So I stop my sharing. So let me open it again. Okay, so statue share. Do you see it correctly? You see my screen full size? Someone can tell me if it's okay. I see. Yes, we do. Yes, thanks a lot. So, what I will discuss with you in the next minutes is maybe another aspect that can contribute to augmented reality, and especially for surgical applications, and especially in the OR. Yes, no, it's not the right slide. Yeah, the right slide. So we have all the same motivation, is to do better. Of course, surgery is very successful nowadays. We do a lot better than we did years ago, centuries ago, of course. But there are still challenges associated with surgery, and this what we hope is to develop technological solutions that may help to overcome these challenges. So if we look through the evolution of surgery, we see where we are in the middle. So we were able, thanks to our developments, to provide the surgeons to different data and information and devices, which helps him or her to take the decision and to improve and to optimize the action. What we can see from this middle line is that the surgeon is sometimes overloaded with data, information, and screens and devices, and we all know about that, and that was one of the main motivations sometimes for augmented reality. We know the limitation of that, and that explains sometimes why some of our developments are not used in the OR. I'm talking about daily use, and you can see sometimes a neural navigation system or robotic system that stay out of the OR even if they are purchased by the hospitals, because sometimes they are too complex to use or they overload the workload, the cognitive and mental workload of the surgeon. So there is really something to do here, which is about facilitating the integration of information together with increasing the number of data that is available to the surgeon. So the only way to do that is to, of course, try to synthesize this information, this data and this information, and all the assistance to help the surgeons to be able more easily to understand this assistance. So this is what we have in mind when we talk about an intelligent operating room, is really to depends on the term that are used. It could be OR of the future or whatever. So it's really about that. So this integration is trying to, so it includes two axes. One is about computing. So in order to perform this integration, we have to work on the analysis, on the computing, on the modeling, and there is another axis which is about representation, visualization, and interaction. I'm convinced that augmented reality should work on both aspects. So, and I think we are all convinced about that. It's not only about representation and visualization and interaction. It's also about thinking about what kind of assistance through augmented reality we want to give and to provide to the surgeon. So the people's my colleagues know how I like to do schemes, diagram, and framework. So what I tried to do in a previous book chapter of a book that was edited by Terry, where most of you are participating. I think there are two aspects in augmented reality, and specifically we have to be very, very clear about what kind of information can be given through augmented reality system that may help the surgeon to perceive the environment, to understand the environment for helping. So I'm reading the scheme from the bottom to the top. And for helping not only the decision, the action, but also the validation, the assessment, the evaluation of the action afterwards. So it's finally augmented reality, but you all know about that, is quite complex. It's not only about visualization. So what I try to do in the book chapter, but it's not the content of this presentation today, is try to think about the cognitive aspect of augmented reality, of the augmentation aspect. What does it mean, and how we can work on that? What I want to do today is to discuss about this aspect more from the point of view of what is usually called situation awareness. So considering that augmented reality should improve the awareness that a surgeon may have about the situation in the operating room. So what we plan, one objective of what we want to do with augmented reality is to improve the situation awareness by making it more automatic, more objective, more quantitative, and using augmented reality, but not only, of course. So what is the situation? What is the work domain? That's the term that I used in the previous work. What is the situation? So it's easy. It's the picture you see here in your screen. There are people, so there are devices, there is a patient. So it's a multidimensional world that includes the patient, but not the patient only. The situation is about the people also who are working in the operating room, the people and also the devices. They are part of the situation. They are part of the work domain, and also the procedure. What happens from the technical point of view, or from a procedural point of view, from events, what are the life of the OR, also from the functional point of view. And when we want to do situation awareness, and when we want to help the surgeon to better understand the situation, it's not only about the patient, it's about also, again, the effectors, the process, the events, the functions, which are in the operating room. Well, this is one point. The second point about situation awareness, the first was about situation. The second point is, what does it mean, the awareness? So this is clearly defined. This is not something that I invented. Situational awareness, or awareness, includes four stages. First, you have to perceive the environment. You have to perceive the work domain. Secondly, from the perception that you have, so I'm talking about situation awareness in general, it's not only computer-assisted situation awareness, but situation awareness, how it works from a psychological point of view for us humans also. So we perceive, then from the perception, we recognize what has been perceived. So we have sensors that sense the environment and then the situation. And then from these signals that we receive, from the data that we receive, we recognize what is inside this data. So we go from data to information. And then the third stage is understanding. So we move from recognizing to understanding what happens. So try to extract some rules, some logics about what is happening currently in the situation. So data, information, and knowledge. We start to know what is happening. We start to understand what is happening. And the fourth and last stage is about predicting. So in situation awareness, the last stage is to be able to predict the next state of the situation, the next state of the environment, and then being able to take the right decision. So this is really about taking the right decision. Perception, recognition, understanding, and prediction. We sense what is happening, what is around us. We recognize from the sensing. We understand from this information that we recognize, isolated information. And finally, from that, from what is happening, we predict what may happen next in our situation. So what I'm talking about doing computer-assisted situation awareness, I'm really talking about implementing these four stages with computer software and hardware. Let's start with perception. So most of you understand that, it's not so complex to understand. So how we perceive, so what we can do from point of view of researchers in digital technologies, we put sensors, so we rely on sensors, we develop sensors sometimes, that may be available in the in our work domain, let's say in DOR, sensors that can be videos or can be kinematic or whatever. So if we try to classify, it's not an exhaustive classification. I did it yesterday just for the presentation today, but just to show that sensors can be multimodal and can address different aspects of the situation, of the environment, of the work domain. So it could be medical imaging, as we know, intraoperative, preoperative, postoperative, that may sense main aspect regarding to the patient. Could be video, so we know about surgical videos coming from microscope, endoscope, RGBD cameras, PTZ cameras, which are selling mounted. We can also use physiological signals or kinematic data. So there are many multimodal sensors that may be used to sense the environment. Then once we have this data, so we need to go from the data to the information to recognize what is inside these signals. And for that, what we do nowadays is we rely on computer vision and machine learning. So this is something which is not so new. We started almost 15 years ago, if it's not more, Nasir also was one of the first working on that aspect, which is to use computer vision and machine learning to recognize what is inside the videos, what is inside the signals, the kinematic data, or whatever. So the principles are quite obvious. So we, like it is in any machine learning approach, we annotate. So in that case, annotation can be done, as we see here, by an observer. We annotate the situation, and we have descriptions of situations, of different situations. And when we want to do it from a machine learning point of view, then we have a second stage from the annotations and from the signals. So we learn a way to automatically recognize with a network to automatically recognize new signals. So we have this training stage. So just to give you an example. So I don't know why the slide is not moving to the next one. Okay. Just to give you an example on how we do that for the procedural dimension. So to recognize the procedural dimension of the situation, we need a vocabulary to do the annotation. So this vocabulary rely on a global description of surgery, which is hierarchical. So a surgical procedures can be described by phases, each phase by steps, each step by actions, each action by surgeons, whatever. So there is a hierarchical way to describe a surgical procedures. Usually what we see is when we are at the action level, we describe, for example, an action as a verb, which is the activity, the surgical instrument used to perform this activity, this verb, the anatomical structure on which the action is performed, starting time, ending time, and sometimes we can add also if it is a right hand or left hand of the surgeon who is doing that, or is it the assistant or the scrum nurse, or is it the robotic system which is performing this action. Of course, to facilitate this work, it's better to have a very formal terminology to describe this procedure elements. And what we suggested with some colleagues is to rely on ontology, which is really the most formal way to represent semantic data. And so we define the OntoSPM ontology, which is of course fully available, to have like a standardized way of describing surgery. Once we have that, we can develop a software that allows to annotate videos, for example, or signals. And what you see here, what you already saw, is an observer who is in the OR, watching what the surgeon, which is in the left side of the video, what the surgeon is doing, and he is annotating all the activities, instrument, and since it is done online, you have the temporal dimension, which is also captured by this annotation. So you can, of course, you can do it online, or you can do it offline, post-operatively. If you record the video, then you can do it more easily sometimes. But of course, you cannot ask a surgeon if there are things you don't understand, but it, you can take more time. So there are advantages for both. However, this annotation is very time consuming. It's very costly in terms of time. Once we estimated that in order to annotate about 1 minute of surgical videos in a very detailed way, it requires about an hour, so an hour for 1 minute, to give you an idea of how costly is annotation of surgical videos. So of course, we cannot do it manually, so that's why also why automatic recognition is important. So once the annotation is done, so there are different ways of implementing machine learning based recognition of video contents. We did it years ago by basic machine learning for cataract surgery to recognize surgical phases, based also on HMM that was pre-computed. More recently, we did what everyone is doing now, is to rely on deep learning aspect, and of course performances are improved. So what you can do also in recognizing the situation is to recognize, to track, to segment, depending on what you want to do, the surgical instruments you see on the video, instruments and needle, for example here. So the video or the situation is a lot more simple than the real surgeries, but as you can see, recognition method are quite robust even in case of large occlusion. You are still able to track the needle. Of course, it's only a bounding box, but it's already a very interesting, very promising. So not only you recognize the procedure, so the actions, but you can also recognize the events. If you learn smoke, for example, presence or absence of smoke in images, so you can automatically recognize the presence of smoke in the surgical videos, or you can, for example, automatically recognize when the video is inside the patient or outside the patient, which, for example, may help to cut to reduce the video size, whatever. Other possibility in doing a situation in recognition of the situation from videos, you can also track the peoples from large view videos. You can track the specialties, for example, differentiate the specialties, or even track some surgical devices like a C-arm system in the OR. So everything can be done from video, but what we also, but we are not the only ones, but what we demonstrate also is that you can do also recognition from kinematic data. So this kinematic data in that case is coming from a robotic system, a research robotic system, the Raven system. And for very simple tasks from the FLS, from the fundamentals laparoscopic skills, the pick and place here, we were able to recognize and to distinguish, to annotate automatically, or to, let's say, to recognize the current activity performed by the trainee from not from video, but from kinematic data only. So there are many things you can do many technological challenges that still exist on this topic. For example, what we studied years ago was can we facilitate the recognition process by learning, because we don't have and annotation is very time consuming, as I said before. Can we compensate the lack of large number of annotations by collecting other sources of data? And what we demonstrated is by adding data coming from text, like post-operative reports or clinical literature, we were able to improve the recognition rate. We are also working on how we can do automatic annotation without automatic recognition without annotation. There are many things that can be done. I don't want to spend too much time on that. And there are many groups that, for instance, also work to multimodal recognition, how you can combine both videos and kinematic data together, which not always improves the recognition rate, but these are interesting directions, research directions. There are other groups that that try to incorporate a priori knowledge in the recognition, and I will talk about that a bit just after. And what is interesting that nowadays there are data sets available, and especially, for example, at Next MICAI in a few weeks from now, there are many challenges on the Friday, October 1st, I think so, that provide data sets to play and to develop new methods and to compare with the state of the art. So if you are interested on that, I recommend you to have a look on this on these challenges. Once you recognize the content of the sensing data, then you can start understanding what happens, understanding what is inside this this information that you recognize. And we did a lot of research on trying to understand this data. For example, the first thing that we studied is if you have a set of surgical procedures, for example, which have been recognized and which are described as a list of what we said previously as a list of steps or stages, can you combine all this descriptions of surgical procedures into one representation, into one model, one graph, to understand the variability of surgical procedures? And you can imagine what we can do with that. And so what we studied, of course, it's not only the graph. You can just concatenate the different procedures into one graph, but what is interesting is to optimize this graph. And so there is a lot of work that can be done in this optimization of graphs. It's not easy because it's not easy to connect nodes just mathematically, because behind these nodes you have and what you can see in the next slide, behind this node you have surgical actions, surgical terms, and what you see here, it's a graph describing the first minutes of its neurosurgery procedure. I think it's disectomy. I think it's a disectomy. And so when you zoom into this graph, what you see, each node is an action. So that include a surgical instrument, an anatomical structure. So what you see here is the variability of surgery, even which seem very complex, even in the case of quite standardized surgery like disectomies. So again, once you increase the number of observations and you have, when you start with a and you don't try to optimize this graph. You, even by concatenating, you have a graph which becomes very complex with a lot of connections. So you also need to work on simplification of this this kind of graphs to be useful. And so we try to address that by, for example, relying on the on PetriNet-like methodology. So you can define graphs which represent the whole surgical procedures, but you can also work on or try to look for small sequences that you can find in surgical procedures that are common between surgeries or between surgeons. And here, for example, we made a study on a very simple task where we demonstrated that it is so the video is not working, but it's not so important. But what we demonstrated is that we can find common patterns, what we call sequential signatures, between surgeons. So small, short moments in surgeries where they do exactly the same patterns, the same sequence of activities. So my computer is waiting. So I think the video was too big. I hope I don't have to reset my computer. It runs. I have the beautiful, colorful circle. Okay, so I need to probably need to start my PowerPoint again. Sorry for that. I stopped sharing. Sorry for that. It may happen. Quit PowerPoint. Or launch it again from that menu, which works this way. And then I can share again and try this way. That will be maybe easier. Share the screen. I think it's good. It's probably works this way. So once you have a recognize several surgeries. So you have what you see here, like a collection of different descriptions of surgeries. You can start also not only merging this surgery, but you can start also comparing these surgeries from a procedural point of view. So for example, what you see here is, and what we tried to do is to try to propose metrics that are able to compute differences between this representation, this procedural representation of surgery. So in that case, you compare the surgical processes that were used and followed by the surgeons for the same type of surgery, and you try to understand why there are differences, if there are differences, and why there are differences. And for example, with a French colleague, we spend a lot of time trying to work to compare, to develop metrics to compare this surgery without taking into account time, for example, and by compensating global differences and local differences. And what we saw is that when we do that, we are able to develop metrics that really compare the procedural aspect of surgery, the way a surgeon is doing the receipt. The signature that I said just before. And if we do that, we can automatically recognize clinical sites, level of expertise, and even individual way of performing surgeries. What we also showed in another study is that we are able to, just only by relying on metrics based on this sequential description of surgeries, we are also able to display this learning curve effect where at the beginning there is this high learning and then there is a plateau coming afterwards. So you can do globally between surgeries, but you can also start to identify the differences between surgeries, but locally, and demonstrate, for example, that another work that we did with Germain Forestier, we can identify locally differences between novices and experts and show that here in red, this action was really significant of a novice action. And so it really local differences. So this was the analysis. So next step, there was understanding and analysis. So the next step is about a prediction. So we say perception, recognition, understanding, and prediction. So how we can predict the next step, for example, or the next action. So they are similarly, you can imagine that you can develop methods, approaches that that can try to predict the next action, knowing that you have a learning data set of previous surgeries. So we did some work on that aspect with Germain based on DTW, also here adapted the DTW, of course, and we were able to predict the next action in a quite accurate way, of course, in the limitation of the learning data set that we had at this time, and of in a limited in a data set which were, for example, not a multi international or it was only on one single clinical site, and that facilitates this prediction. What is also interesting is not only to predict the next action, but also to predict what we say is a different aspect of the situation. So predicting about the patient, predicting about the effectors and the actors, predicting about the processes. And what we tried to do more recently is it possible also from the perception, recognition, and understanding to predict also the success of surgery, the performance of surgery. So not only if it is done, if the process that is followed is the right process, but also if the result is the right result. So we can do well with a wrong process, or we can follow the right process but having a wrong result. So it's important to study both. So what we of course we are not at this point yet, but how we started to address that was, for example, try to predict the quality of exposure at one time of surgery by relying on surgical videos, and that's a way to, it's a local way, so we are very far from predicting the success of surgery, but it's a step to analyze and to predict the success of local and we say crucial and critical points of a surgical procedure. So, for example, here is exposure in the context of laparoscopic surgery. So, this exposure time is very important. So, it could be it's a way to predict how well the prediction is done here from the sensing. What we also tried to do recently was to try to automatically identify the deviations. So something which is not expected, which is not usual. So and try to do it to predict early when the surgical procedure is going out of the usual way. And classify in that case. What we did was to classify to distinguish what could be a usual deviation or a load deviations compared to a risk deviations that may conduct to an adverse event. So that was the study. Or to be honest, for both studies, we are still far from correct performances, and there are still a lot of work to be done to improve the results, the performance of this prediction algorithm. But this is a direction where we are working, and to summarize it in a scheme. So what we would like to do is so we have the sensors. Through the sensor, we understand the situation, and then we predict the performance and the clinical outcome. So really, what we want to do is really to make the link between the situation and the prediction of the situation, and eventually the prediction of the of local or global outcome and success of surgery. So as you saw, we talked about perception, we talked about recognition, we talked about understanding, and we talked about prediction. So how can it be used in the OR? So and where is the connection with augmented reality? I'm starting to be far from augmented reality. So let's go back to augmented reality. So we really believe that situation awareness is a way to optimize the assistance, so to provide a more relevant assistance. And initially the motivation of why we started studying the situation awareness. The initial motivation was about augmented reality. And what we wanted to do at this time was really to try to display with an augmented reality system the right information at the right moment, to explain you in a more concrete way. With some students, we developed an augmented reality system for neurosurgery that we implemented in a surgical microscope to display multimodal data in the OR. We tested it with more than 30 patients in the OR. So it was in, you can see publication was in 2002. And there was a moment when I remember quite well, the surgeon told me, okay, you took the picture for your publication. So can you remove all these augmented reality features? Because, and then I can start working because it's a mess, the information you showed to me. So I started to question myself about the relevance of all that technology. And of course, what the surgeon was saying, that it's an overload of information, and what we had to do is to just to display the right information at the right moment to really be relevant in the assistance. So we started to develop a software that we're able to, from the identification of the main stages of the surgical procedure, just the surgeon was able to identify which kind of information and images he wanted to, or she wanted to see during surgery with the augmented reality system. And we implemented that years ago by using Agestic, which was an open source navigation software developed by Kevin. Not only, but mainly managed by Kevin Carey. And we did that, so we implemented the procedural aspect in the software, where you were able to go from one step to another step and display the only relevant information at one time. Another application that was demonstrated as a prototype with the University of Leipzig. I was collaborating with them at this time, and I like really this video that was like the procedural navigator. So that when you know where you are and when you can predict, so you can help navigate into the procedures, and like a car navigation system. Of course, there are other things you can do with this with this relevant assistant. So I don't want to spend too much time on these pictures, but when you are, for example, working through a Da Vinci console, you lose the connection with the operating room. So being able to put more information in the console, for example, it's a way to keep the surgeon aware about the situation. Another application, which is a project that a national project that we conducted with Strasbourg, was to work on the control tower, on surgical control tower, and how you can facilitate the browsing of all this information coming from different operating rooms. So just to conclude and to give time for some questions and discussion, situation awareness is really a way thinking about assistance, computer assistance in the OR. It's a way to provide more relevant information and to keep the surgeon in connection with his or her environment, where it may have really a strong impact on the quality of surgery. So this is really the motivation. It's also a way to have what I call, it's maybe overused, but an intelligent collaboration between humans and machines, because in that case, your computer becomes aware also about the situation, because he's the one who computes and recognize and predict. So he's aware about the situation. So he's able to adapt his assistance, his user interface according to the situation, which is the case, for example, in augmented reality, but it could be also the case for surgical robotics. And there are teams we are working with that are trying to implement a situation awareness also for surgical robots. So it's a way to, when I say intelligent, is also a way to ensure that the link is done correctly between two worlds, the real and the virtual world, the real and the computerized world. Of course, everything is not only just to play with the technology and to develop exciting a new system, but of course we need always and for every system we do and we develop every concept, we need to keep in mind that what we want to do is to improve the quality of life of the patients, but also the quality of life of the professionals, and this is our main motivation. Thank you for your attention, and I think so, Matthias. I have time for questions. If you are all here. Well, I don't hear you, but I see you, which is.
I just came quickly to thank you again for joining us. It's really, really a pleasure to have you. And so, so much really valuable and rich information, which I totally follow you. Without this intelligence, without this modeling, without this, data science that you're talking, augmented reality could not be integrated well and be really appreciated being integrated into the system. I just wanted to thank you again for your time and for your contribution. I leave it to Ray to manage the questions and
answers. Okay, thanks a lot, Nasir. It's great to see you too.
Okay, well, there's about 100 people out there watching visually. We're gonna field things. I'll bring them from the chat to you. Steve Patterson gave a question right during your talk. He was wondering, how do you derive the surgical, the graph models for the representations of the surgical process model? His question was whether it's machine learning, whether it's in-person annotation, et cetera. But I think you can even broaden that and describe how you generate those surgical process models.
Yes, It's a right question, also because there are many challenges around that. In the results that I showed, the graphs were generated from manually annotated data. So we did it before having, I would say, quite robust recognition system. But you can do it with both. I mean, we don't mind. The main point is about the uncertainties that may be associated with some of the actions or phases or steps you compute. But in any case, even when it is a manual annotation or manual observation, you have all those uncertainties. So you can use both. So the idea is really, let's consider that you observe to, or you have 10 surgery of the same discectomy type of surgery and for the same type of patients with the same pathology, for example, with the same surgeons. What could explain if there are some differences? What could explain these differences? Maybe some differences are just natural. We can independently, you can do ABC or ACB. There is no impact. But sometimes you may have some impact. So this is really to being able to identify this procedural variability. And also, if you do it well, it's a way you can use these graphs really to help prediction. And even you can use these graphs to help recognition, of course, because it may give you some a priori knowledge that may facilitate recognition.
Yeah. Well, I mean, it's a ripe, open problem.
Roy, I don't hear you anymore. I think I was hearing you through Matthias' laptop. And Matthias, you switch off the microphone.
It got unmuted, yeah. Yeah, I mean, it's a lot of open questions. I find it really exciting because it's just like you can imagine a representation of a behavior with a flowchart or a state diagram, but any one particular path through that leads to an interaction diagram. And it's the interaction diagram that you're pulling from your data. You're trying to invert that and get the overall process model. It's really a beautiful challenge for research. I'll just push along from that. Paul Schramm has a question. His question was much more polite, but I'm going to paraphrase. Hey, a nice talk, but where's the AR here? you might want to field this. You've done a lot of stuff on using VR for training, but in addition, I think your quote, putting the right information at just the right moment is where it's really ripe for AR.
Yeah, definitely. That's what I said at the beginning. Maybe I should have coming back to this notion. If we want to have a relevant augmentation, that's the point, whatever it is through a microscope or glasses, if we want to have relevant augmentation, we should think about what we display. So it's not only, it's important, but it's not only how you display, but also what you display. And I think that there is a need in augmented reality to spend a bit more research on that aspect, on the cognitive dimension that is related to augmented reality. And as the example I explained to you regarding the surgeon who asked me to remove the augmented reality features in the surgical microscope. What is exactly this issue of cognitive overload we need to better understand what is needed when and also how. I mean, it's also about the representation, the visual representation.
Okay, thank you. A question from Agnieszka. What about non-visual senses?
Yeah, sure. For me, the visualization and interaction, so the rendering, maybe we can call it this way, and the interaction can be done with different senses. I remember, for example, Jocelyne Trocaz trying to give rendering through the tongue. I don't know if you remember that, where you had some signals going to, so you had to put a small device on your mouth, and there was some information. To, yeah, there are many. It could be haptic information. There are many ways, and definitely this is interesting to study. Of course, the challenge will be how it is accepted and natural for the surgeon, because you totally change. So you bring something completely new. So it may require times to for the surgeons to. So it has to be also very intuitive. But yes, these are things which are interesting to. I mean, Nasir did things with music, for example, the musification aspect, where in navigation, it's not only about visualization.
Just stay online. There are several interesting talks coming out on exactly this topic of sonification. So coming up. All right. Here's a question for you, which is not a softball question. One in the audience here, whose name will be nameless, but it is Leo, asking a question which really pulls the rug of the whole foundations. The question from Leo is, you know, is it always the case that individual surgical gestures will be tied to surgical outcomes? Are surgical outcomes always a function of what we see and observe in microcosm?
Yeah, of course, it's an important challenge. I think the surgical outcome is a function of many parameters, and in these parameters there is the action, but there is also, and we all know about that, and there are also other parameters, and of course some are related to the patient, some are related to the devices you use, some are related to the team which is working with you. There are also some physiological or even psychological states of the surgeon that may explain that sometimes he works or she works better than other day. Yes, definitely. So it's a very complex problem with a lot of input parameters, and outcomes is also a multidimensional concept. So it's not only about clinical outcome. It may be also about the cost, or as we said, maybe the simplicity or the comfort for the surgeon. So yes, there are still many things to study in that direction. The function between input and output data, between what you have as input, what may change the process. So you have input data, you have the process, and you have the results, which is the same for training, for example. And you spoke about training. Similarly, in training, you have the success of the task. But of course, it's not only about the success. We know it's also about the way you do it. So I'm not saying that there is only one way of doing things, but there are optimized ways, and this is usually where you see surgeon experts, because they optimize their process, optimize their activity. Maybe the outcome would be the same with a surgeon who is with a bad posture that may give him pain in his back in 10 years from now. The outcome should be the same. But as I said, there are other measures that may be taken into account. So yes, it's not done yet. We don't have all the functions yet.
Yeah. Okay. Thank you very much for handling that difficult question. You know which Leo I'm talking about, right?
Yes, of course. Hi, Leo.
All right. Alan Caffey has many of the people watching are sold on this approach. It is very exciting. And we have a question here. How did you gather this data? How can I gather this data? Did you make use of haptic devices? When can I get these data sets?
So Well, there are many ways of collecting such data. And most of the data we have is video and kinematic. But we are working now with other sensor, other modality, more complex one. And I know Marco from Boston also was recording physiological information of the surgeon during surgery, Marco Zenati. We do things similar also here. So you can do you can use as much sensors depending of your questions. What you can find easily on the web if you want to start working on that direction is videos. So there are some video data sets which are freely available, which are usually used for challenges. And there is, of course, this well-known Jigsaw's data set that includes both videos and kinematic data. We also released last year, and we expanded this year, a data set with a video kinematic annotation for a training task.
For some of the newcomers to the domain, and there are many who have come into this area through this Mars Summer School, it might be helpful if you put out a link to some of those data sets on there. Not all, but just maybe a couple to get people started.
Sure. We'll do that just after.
Yes. You can chat anytime. People will see it.
Yes.
And I think we've landed that perfectly. Here in Zurich, it's 6 o'clock. Are we ready to make the transition to the... Okay, perfect. Thank you, Pierre.
Roy, thanks a lot. My only concern is that I was not able to see you and Leo and Nasir lively in Zurich, but the next time, I love Zurich City too, so that will be next time. Bye-bye, thanks again.